Hi folks, welcome to Gimo, Sweden. We are here at the world's largest cemented carbide facility to look at how Sandvik Coromant makes both their cemented carbide, aka inserts or cutting tools, as well as the soft bodies or the tool holders. Those lathe holders, those milling holders, Cat 40 type holders, Cap 2 holders, etc. here at their factories. It's one of the coolest factories I've ever had the chance to tour, and is by far the most cutting edge in the extensive use of both automation, but more than just automation, it's pulling all that automation together with data. To say that I'm excited to come see this facility is an absolute understatement, but what's even more amazing is I think we're the first folks that Sandvik has ever let bring a camera into this facility and show you guys some of the magic behind how these inserts and how these soft bodies are made. So folks, I'm going to kind of overdub the chance we had to go tour through this facility. We'll talk about what we learned, the takeaways, just some awesome footage, some really cool machines, but stay tuned for the end. There's a pretty cool surprise in the form of a machine that you might even recognize. Let's dive in. The first thing we saw when we walked into this facility, aside from kind of a showcase of some of the products that they make, were forklifts everywhere, but not the forklifts you're used to seeing. They are all autonomous and intelligent, and not just intelligent as if they can back up to charge themselves at a charging port or follow tracks overhead, but they're runners. They know what to pick up. They know where to go. They know how to interface with the machining centers, the cells, the inventory systems, the metrology. Just amazing. We saw material come in and it's never really handled by a person. An automatic robot is able to pick it up, able to deliver it to the correct machining cell. That machining cell can then kind of process that material in. It can put it in the correct racking. Or it can get it loaded into the machine. There are no operators here. I didn't see a single person loading parts into a machine. Whether it's midstream process quality control with a CMM that was in the cell, or whether it's CMM that's done after it's done machining, they can process it, outbound it. The same autonomous forklift system will come pick it up, deliver it somewhere else. They're aware of humans. They're able to run down the aisle. You don't have to stay away from them. And the ringer, folks, Sandvik Coromant implemented the first autonomous forklift in 1989. What we're seeing here is their third generation of this technology. To say that they embrace automation and pushing the envelope is absolutely true, more so than I have ever seen in my life. Really good example of how they've set up a dedicated workstation for a machining cell. They've got Kaizen, they've got Lean. You can tell that they're constantly improving because we watch them kind of improve some processes and have team meetings on that. We've got labels for things. They replaced the doors with clear doors so that you could see into this cabinet. You've got something that kind of looks like shaller bins. And click for a card here. Jay Pearson did a video in collaboration with us on how he organizes his toolbox, thinking about what tools you need to have where and how to do that in a machining environment to help you make better decisions and make better parts. Here we're walking up to one of the first truly automated cells. I believe there were 4 5-axis machines in this cell. Some of the cells also had grinding and or CMMs built into them. You've got one large robot in the middle. You can see right through the man door there, they've got 4 different tables, and each table can have 4 different pallets of parts on it, so they can run up to 16 different tools at the same time. And then take a look at the ABB sign and the racking above it. What was awesome, and something I haven't seen as often, was the level of automation and the interfacing with the robots here. It's not just raw material. They've got fixturing, they've got work holding, they've got different collet systems, they've got different tail stocks, they've got different end effectors, they've got the ability to replace or swap out tools and tooling systems. That was not only amazing, but really showed the level of thought and integration that they've put. And what was interesting was we didn't see a lot of high volume type machining like you would see with a horizontal machining center. They talked about their sort of high mix, low volume nature of their product offering. They don't have hundreds of thousands of extra parts in inventory. They tend to operate on a much more lean basis. So again, what we didn't see were tombstones loading into horizontal machining centers producing 5 or 10,000 of any single parts, but rather again, this much, much more flexible system where machines are able to generally complete parts in very few, if not just one operation. A couple of other things I liked about this tour, not only is this one of their largest factories, but they do a tremendous amount of work here and we're able to see what it's really like. So Yeah, they've got some older machining centers, some slightly older technology. They're also constantly churning in new machines. Here, they're setting up two brand new state-of-the-art five-axis machining centers. But that's how the real world works. Very few machine shops ever start from scratch and buy all brand new stuff. A lot of us have to deal with mixing in the old and the new. They also consume a tremendous number of cutting tools here when they're making their soft bodies. So Sandvik Coromant has to buy its own tooling, and that's more than just an accounting thing. I think they do it that way because it's the right way to do it. For any of you who are new to our channel, it reminds me of sort of a key lesson in manufacturing entrepreneurship. And card here to the book, The E-Myth Revisited. Even if you're a garage shop guy, you're just getting started, you're a one-man band, being able to identify different roles and different tasks as a basic org chart is a key thing to do, even again, if you're filling all those roles at the moment. So just because Sandvik Coromant makes cutting tools and they use them, they treat that as an arm's length relationship. So that Sandvik Coromant rep has to call on the Sandvik Coromant factory, and he's got to be proving why their tools are the best value, the best technology, the right fit, and the right decision for them to use. I like that. So our factory tour guide, who was an phenomenal, charismatic, and very knowledgeable fellow, is explaining that the cell automatically pulled out the first two pieces, puts them aside, and waits until the QC process, whether that's automatic or manual, has approved that, done a first piece inspection before it continues running the rest of them. Awesome. Here we're walking up to a cell. I believe this was making one of the smaller captives. I believe maybe a C3. Looks like a type of turning tool for a captive spindle. So that could be a turret or it could be in a mill turn spindle. It's a forging. And he's just talking about the process of how they inbound that material, how they're going to do machining here. They're going to do grinding. They're going to do heat treat. They're going to do tempering. They're going to do black oxiding. Again, doing quality control throughout that whole process and how few people ever touch that part. I think in this example, it was zero. Another interesting thing, they're doing a lot more dry machining. They're able to get rid of coolant. They're able to get equal, if not better, results. And as a machinist, I would love to not have to use coolant. So that's something on my list to kind of think about and research more and understand in steel and cast iron or aluminum, how and when can you get by cutting dry? Here we're stopped at the backside of a grinding machine and looking at what is effectively a fire extinguisher. Now, why a fire extinguisher? But more importantly, why is it sitting on what looks like a very special base? This machine has been tied in with this fire extinguisher, and the machine will not run unless the fire extinguisher has the correct amount of weight inside of it, meaning the fire extinguisher has enough capacity to put out a fire. Because when you're grinding, you create dust, and you're often using cutting oil. Fires are a real risk or a real potential. Obviously, there's zero interest or zero tolerance in those occurring. So if a fire is detected, not only will this fire extinguisher immediately put it out, but they are, I believe, wired in with other alarms and systems, but also the machine just simply won't run if it's obviously been depleted, and it prevents any sort of situation from occurring where a fire needs to be put out, but the fire extinguisher isn't filled up and able to do so. Really, really cool. One of the big takeaways for me here was not just their capabilities and the breadth of product and the operations of a factory and automation, but big data or managing all this data, the systems that they have in place. And you can use all these buzzwords like ERP or Internet of Things, but the reality is it was amazing to see the level of information they had accessible, not only within this facility, but a lot of their other facilities around the world, and how deep that they could dive into production level information about materials level, about inventory levels, about machine performance, about maintenance, both proactive and reactive maintenance. Just absolutely amazing. So what is a carbide insert? Well, it's mostly about 80% tungsten. That's the element, and that's what gives it most of its strength. There's 20% though, it's left over, that's a bunch of different metals that make it so special. The majority though is cobalt, and cobalt is the binder. They start as all these various metals or minerals. They mill them or grind them up together, just like you would mixing up a recipe in the kitchen. They store them in barrels, but then when they're ready to use them, they've got specific recipes or grades ready to go, and they take that powder and they put it into a press. So this would be very similar to how you would press a pharmaceutical pill. What's crazy is that when they press it to a size that's about 50 to 60% larger than what they actually want it to be in the end, because the next stage here, you see this oven, is sintering. Sintering makes it hard, almost as hard as a diamond. And when it sinters, it shrinks. Luckily, they know exactly how much it's going to shrink. They've cut that down to a science, but nevertheless, it's pretty cool to see how oversized they are when they're originally pressed. After that, most sensors are ground. Sometimes the chip breakers have to be ground in. Sometimes those were able to be formed earlier when they were pressed. Then they're coated, and that's the last stage. Got various different types of PVD, physical vapor deposition, as well as CVD, chemical vapor deposition. And then they're ready to be packaged up. But along the whole way, a huge amount of quality control and data is gathered about that batch to try to fix mistakes and catch mistakes as early as possible when they come up. Folks, I told you there'd be a cool surprise at the ending. Here we are. Does anyone recognize this machine? I about fell over when I saw it. This video made the rounds a year or two ago on kind of the social media and internet machining world, and it's impressive. Card here to watch it, but I had no idea that this was at Sandvik, let alone at the factory we had the chance to tour. This is amazing. Fully integrated, dynamic manufacturing. And it's really pulling in a lot of what we've already talked about. You got to sell on a mill turn machine that's intelligent. It's able to mill and turn as a lathe. It's able to handle different work pieces, different chucking systems. Just absolutely amazing and cutting edge. I could have sat there for 2 hours and just watched it.
Just finished up the tour walking through where they make what they call soft bodies. So the bodies for the drills, the bodies for the face mills, just absolutely amazing. I want to go take a bunch of notes and do like a recap video walking through all the little nuggets and things you learn about lean automation and how they just very, very, very cool. It's a big thanks to Sandvik for letting us come and for letting us film.